That's right.
Up next, Bryan is also out there in the cold.
Neighborhood weather tonight goes back home to New York. Hi, Bryan.
Hi, Diane and Art from a very cold Central Park in New York. You know, we're waiting on the snow here in New York and Boston. If you're from the Northeast, they never could forecast the snowstorms here, and they still can. Of course, as you say, dangerous cold tonight in South Florida. We'll have that story and all the weather when Neighborhood Weather comes back live from New York, New York.
You know, with Bryan in New York, he had to go for the big finish. What a nice surprise, huh?
I'll tell you, it's amazing who you run into in the Big Apple.
Where'd you find her?
Oh, she was just over there at NBC, but, you know, you think she'd come out in this cold weather, forget it. I'm on tape. Michelle is busy this afternoon, but she did want to say hello to everybody in South Florida. And I'm really just about as glad I'm here. What a great time to be out of South Florida. Let's cover the South Florida important stuff first. We're going for 31 degrees tonight. In the coldest spots in Miami. That's not in the farming district, that's in Miami. So certainly you're going to want to protect the pets, plants, and foreign cars. Bring them all in, and you should be okay. And that coldest temperature will come near morning, by the way, so you should be okay through the evening before the wind dies down. Okay, let's go on to New York here. We're in Central Park now, looking out on Sheep Meadow. Now, Central Park was a swampy area into the middle of the last century. In fact, sheep grazed here up until the 1930s. And then the city held a contest. They decided they needed a park and a landscaping contest. And the winner came and said, this is what we should do. Every tree in Central Park was planted. Every stream was put in. This actually was nothing like this before they started. In 1858, the city bought this land. So little thing you remember when you come up to Central Park. Let's start our tour of New York by grabbing the IRT and heading downtown. The New York subway system isn't what it used to be, for better and for worse. New cars mean better service, new paint means the graffiti is mostly gone, but the majesty of the mosaic tile and the decorative trim of the old stations is only barely visible these days through years of grime and neglect. Still, if you want to get there today, this is the only way to go.
There were already almost 4 million people in New York in 1904 when the Interborough Rapid Transit Company, the IRT, opened the first subway line. It ran under Broadway here through Midtown. Then in 1908, the IRT opened that first tube under the East River, and for the first time, you could ride under the river all the way to Brooklyn.
Welcome back. Your dreams were your ticket out.
Brooklyn is looking better and better these days as the cost of living in Manhattan has gone out of sight. Prospect Park, laid out by the designer of Central Park, is as beautiful as ever, and the buildings nearby are finding a magnificent second wind. A beautifully renovated old area is Brooklyn Heights. It was settled in the early part of the 1800s because the ferry came over from Manhattan and ended in this area, and this was the core of the city of Brooklyn at that time. Even grand old Borough Hall is finally getting a makeover.
Boy, the way Glenn Miller played.
Songs that made the hit parade.
Guys like us, we had it made.
Those were the days.
It's only a 4-minute ride across the East River, but there wasn't much to Queens until the factories moved in early this century. Company towns like Archie Bunker's Astoria, Steinway, and Long Island City were settled by the workers that came for the jobs, but Queens still had a lot of room to grow. In the 30s, the city of New York undertook a massive expansion of the subway, independent of private money, called the IND, and that brought new subway lines out here to Queens, under Queens Boulevard, to Forest Hills here and beyond. Forest Hills Gardens was sold as a special suburban development in 1911, an island in the middle of the country.
It's even more special today, an island in the middle of the commercial sprawl of Queens.
There's a holdup in the Bronx, car 54, where are you?
Things have changed a lot on Tremont Avenue in the 26 years since car 54 patrolled the South Bronx. You can't help but wonder what's gone wrong.
It was back in 1892 they designed the Grand Concourse as a speedway to bring Manhattanites up to the park areas that were here in the Bronx at that time. Then in the 30s, mostly Jewish immigrants moved to this area, and they lived in the Art Deco and Art Modern buildings you still see here today.
In the late 50s, the Cross Bronx Expressway ripped through this neighborhood, and things haven't been the same since. Not far away, the beauty of the old Bronx remains. And north of Fordham Road, it's like a different world, where neighborhoods like Bronxdale are alive and doing fine.
And here's New York's main street, Broadway. It was an old Indian trail that came down the island. Then in 1811, the city designed the grid system, but they couldn't afford to buy out the old businesses along Broadway, so Broadway stayed and created lots of little squares and triangles. The most famous one is Times Square.
Of course, Broadway is more than a street. It's a sensation, the lights, the sounds, the center of the city, that in many ways is the center of the world. Main Street, New York, New York.
New York, New York, and it's freezing here today, I'll tell you. You know, New York has always been the biggest city in the country, starting with the 1790 census, which was the first U.S. census. New York was the biggest. Then in 1898, Brooklyn came in, and it became, by large measure, the biggest, and, of course, still by far the biggest city today. Let's go ahead and check on that cold weather down in South Florida. Temperatures in the 50s today. Just about exactly what we said, we're very pleased to say. You see a 54 at Palm Beach, 56 Dania, 57 at West Miami, and a 59 Homestead, and down at Stock Island, the warm spot here in South Florida. Here in Central Park this afternoon, my thermometer says 27 degrees, but as I look back down toward downtown, thermometer there says 24, another one says 22. So get rid of that thing. All right, let's go ahead and see what's on the satellite picture. The storm that we've been waiting for here in the northeast, you see the swirl in the clouds off Delaware. That is just veering just far enough to the east to give heavy snow to New Jersey. And out on Long Island, they're getting snow, but it looks like it's going to miss the city. They still say we may see a flake or two, but we're not really expecting anything significant here. And in South Florida, you see clouds all the way around the peninsula from the cold air over the warm water, but nothing over the state. So here's the forecast now for South Florida for any kind of boating. You have to be nuts to be boating, but small craft advisory continues tonight. By tomorrow, the winds will start dying down, become more northerly. That'll bring a little bit of warmth in, so we're expecting a little warmer weather tomorrow. There's the high and low tide government cut, and the air quality is good today. So for tonight, now, frost and freeze possible, even in the city, will be close to the coldest ever recorded in Miami. That would be a 30. We're forecasting 31 in the coldest locations, warmer at the beach and the Keys. Tomorrow, sunny, not as cold, not as windy. We're heading up 62, and we'll be significantly warmer on Sunday, okay? So now from New York, we're actually going to be a little better tomorrow with sun coming out and temperatures up near freezing, but it should be at least better than this. All right, I'll tell you the most important thing I want to stress here is I'm very glad this didn't come up back when it was 76 below in Alaska. And I'm also counting on being a lot warmer by the time I get back to South Florida.
We're ready to have you home. And Brian, thank you so much for this week. It was a lot of fun.
Okay,
and
we'll see you Monday.
We should also say that Al Rodriguez is a very talented photographer behind all those wonderful
pictures.
Did a
superb job, didn't they?